Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Stupid Fast by Geoff Herbach, narrated by Fred Berman and directed by Shane O'Connell.
Chapter 1. Now. This could be a dark tale. It's not. I don't think so. Maybe. I can't sleep. It's 1:03 a.m., almost September. The weather is warm, even though it's football season. There's this huge moon in the sky, but I can't see it from the basement where my bedroom is. I saw it plenty. Tonight. Dark tale? My dad did commit suicide. Not so dark. I'm me. I hop up and down. Where to start? Not in the 70s, when Jerry was a little girl. Not 10 years ago, when I was 5 and found Dad dead in the garage. How about last November? I should really be exhausted, but I'm not. I, Felton Reinstein, stand on my bed because I can't sleep. Go. Chapter 2. My body grew hair. I am not stupid funny. I am stupid fast. My last name is Reinstein, which is not a fast name. But last November, while I was a sophomore, my voice finally dropped, and I grew all this hair on my legs and other places, and then I got stupid fast. I'm serious. Before my voice dropped in the fall, when my class was outside for gym, I played flag football and felt like trying for some reason. I was pretty good, because even though I hadn't yet fully gone through puberty like all the chuckleheads in my grade, and never tried before and wasn't even interested in the slightest, I've always been good at sports, a fact I hid by not trying, but not ridiculously good. Then Thanksgiving came. And I couldn't stop eating. And I couldn't wake up before, like, noon, which drove Jerry nuts. And I grew taller, and I got all this crazy hair. The hair was like corn coming up in June. You look one day, and there are sprouts in the dirt, but mostly you see dirt. And then, like, a week later, those sprouts aren't sprouts, but corn, and are already knee-high, and you can't see the dirt at all. I ate too much at Thanksgiving, about 1,000 pounds, and I couldn't wake up in the morning, and I sprouted hair. A week later, I had 1,000 pounds of hair everywhere. Then, because my voice dropped, I got moved to baritone for the Christmas concert, which was bad news because I didn't know the parts at all, so I sang the tenor parts except an octave below, which you could totally hear. And it went on. I kept sleeping and eating, and Jerry yelled at me to get out of bed, and I yelled at Andrew to stop playing the piano so I could sleep. So Jerry yelled at me for yelling at Andrew, and I'd get pissed and get out of bed and go to the refrigerator and stuff bread in my mouth because I was so hungry. Then Jerry would yell at me for eating too fast, and Andrew would shout, "Felton's a pig," and on all winter. My pants getting too short and my shirts looking shrunken, not covering my belly button, which is gross. Jess Withrow and Abby Sauter told me it was gross, and Jerry and Andrew shouting at me and me shouting back. Jerry never yelled before November. And then in the spring, my gym class had to go outside to run the 600-yard dash for some physical fitness test thing, apparently the last one we ever have to do, and I was just mad, all wound up from all the yelling and my clothes not fitting right. And when Coach Knouch, the gym teacher, yelled go, I took off. I ran like an angry donkey, a very fast one, even though I didn't care about winning. I just needed a release. I sprinted all 600 yards, and I beat everybody, even the other fast kids, by about 150 yards. People were screaming, "Look at Rhinestone go!" Peter Yang, my second best friend, whispered, "What happened to you?" Hee-haw! I shouted and pumped my fist. Peter Yang rolled his eyeballs and walked away. Jerry, who happens to be my mom, but also a big hippie who doesn't like hierarchy, so she's always had me and Andrew call her by her first name, was all puffy and weird during dinner that night. She was a crossing guard at the middle school at the time. The middle school is right next to the high school, but lets out a little earlier so the high school kids don't scare and beat the pee out of the middle school kids. She was out there on the corner when I ran the 600. She saw it. I could hear her screaming from the corner. Run, Felton! Go! Oh my God! Felton, she said, serving me and Andrew whole grain organic macaroni and cheese. Listen, you need to do something about that speed of yours. Oh, I said, digging in. Are you listening to me? Really, Felton, that speed is a gift from the universe. And I know you need to be who... Need to be who... She sat down at the table and stared up at the ceiling. Who, Jerry? I asked. I heard you're fast, Felton. Andrew nodded at me. I'm eating macaroni here, I said. Mind your own business. You're super fast, Felton Reinstein. Jerry nodded. She spoke really quietly. It's like you're Jamaican instead of the son of a small, sad Jewish dude. She was referring to me and Andrew's father, who was already long dead, but was in life, so we were to believe, not built for speed. I thought for a moment before sticking more macaroni in my face. Were you fast, Jerry? No, not fast. I played guitar and read poetry. You've got a gift from the... From the universe, Felton.
I'm not fast either, said Andrew. Of course, I wouldn't want to be. Athletic prowess is a curse, I think.
What the hell do you know? I glared at him. He stared back at me through his big plastic nerd glasses. You're a punk middle schooler.
It's just the way I feel, he said.
No, Andrew. Wrong, Jerry said.
I simply think sports are bad for a young man, Andrew said.
No, goddammit, Jerry said, all hot and red-faced. We have to support what the universe provides, do you understand me?
You shouldn't swear, Jerry, Andrew said.
Just shut up, Andrew, Jerry said.
Don't say shut up, Andrew shouted back.
I'm sorry, Jerry said, looking down.
Dad wasn't a Jamaican Jew, was he? I asked.
No, Jerry frowned. Your father was a sweet, fat American Jew.
Then she stood up from the table, walked to the sink, and dropped her bowl of whole grain organic macaroni into it. I didn't even see her take a bite. Jerry was acting a little freaky. This might have been a sign to me, but I didn't really pay attention because she was standard issue weird forever. Big hippie sandals, organic turnip soup, drumming circles, making us call her Jerry. But freaky?
Not really. Well, maybe a little. Sometimes. Off and on.
Jerry wasn't the only one acting weird. Coach Knauts pulled me out of biology the next day. He knocked on Mr. Willard's door, pointed at me while the whole class stared, and then said he had to have a word in private. Private? That's a gross word. It reminds me of bathrooms and people's privates all hanging out. Gross. I was scared. I hadn't gotten in trouble since eighth grade when I took a bathroom stall apart with a screwdriver, totally grounded from TV and suspended for 3 days, which ended my life of crime and vandalism. And I couldn't imagine why a coach would pull me out of class. He walked me down the hall without saying a word. He took me into the gym offices in total silence. He sat me down across the desk from him and then stared at me and shook his head and breathed through his big nose. Yes, Sir? I asked. Listen, Reinstein. I have never seen anything like it. Nose breath.
Like what? I said meekly. I was completely shaking in my shoes because I thought I must have done something horribly terrible.
I have never seen a kid run so damn fast in the fitness test, he said.
Oh, I breathed easier. Yeah, Jerry is pretty excited.
Who? My
mom.
Right, Jerry. And she's right to be excited, Reinstein. I've been doing this for 12 years, and I have never seen anything like it. Ken Johnson wasn't even close to as fast as you, and he took 2 firsts at state last year.
I know, I said without any enthusiasm, I might add. Why? Ken Johnson has always been a jerk. The summer after 8th grade, Ken Johnson shoved me off my Schwinn varsity, which he called a stupid bike, because he said my brake lever scratched his car, which maybe it did, but only because he parked like a jerk so I couldn't get my bike past him. Ken Johnson.
I'm guessing you're a sprinter, Coach Knauts nodded. Just by the way you run, I'm guessing you're really built for 100 meters or maybe 200.
Maybe, I said, still not knowing what he was getting at. Mr. Knauts's eyes were watery. He nodded more. He was sweaty.
You have to do something with your God-given speed. You have to go out for track, he said.
Oh, I said. I squinted and thought, those locker room lights beating down in my head. Am I going to say yes to this silliness? I wouldn't have said yes, but I had Jerry's voice echoing in my head from the macaroni dinner. The universe. The universe. The universe. And I thought about Andrew all arrogant and superior, even though he's just a punk kid. And there was this poster hanging on the wall behind Coach Knauts, I was squinting at it, with this dude running in the desert with the word achieve underneath him. And I was emotionally moved by it, which is ridiculous, I know, but whatever. And yes, I wanted Jerry to be proud of me. Andrew has his thing, his piano, which everyone loves him for. Jerry's so proud of Andrew. Jerry has never seemed proud of me. I mean, man, what young son doesn't want his mom to be proud of him, even if he has to call her Jerry? The universe, Felton. The universe. So, I said, okay, sounds good. Which caused Coach Knauts to punch his fist in the air, shout, yes, and then try to high-five me. So even though track season was half done by that time, and even though I had no intention before to do anything but eat and sleep and grow hair on my body and practice my completely lame and humorless stand-up routine, I'll get to this later, and even though I've always thought that track is dumb because you just run like you're a scared buffalo getting chased by hyenas on Animal Planet, I joined the team. It was right to do so. I was totally nervous about it. The juniors and seniors have always been jerks. But seriously, I did pretty well. In fact, right away it became obvious, even though my last name is Reinstein and not something Jamaican like Bolt or Lightning or Nitro or Napalm, that I'm sincerely fast. Actually, it turned out that I'm so fast that I made varsity in the 100 meters, which pissed off a couple of seniors, boo-hoo, but it wasn't my fault. Coach Knauts kept me off the relays for political reasons, he said. It turned out I could already run almost as fast as that jerk Ken Johnson. All the rest of the spring, a growing crowd of sweaty dudes who looked like Coach Knauts, balding, wearing those elastic coat shorts pulled halfway up their fat bellies because they're also coaches, albeit football coaches, kept coming up to me saying, I've never seen anything like it. You're what, 15? All the rest of the spring, Jerry kept yelling from her crossing guard position out on the corner, or from the stands at other schools, or from next to Andrew at big invitational meets, where I always placed a closer and closer second right behind Ken Johnson. Run, Felton, go! Even as she got freakier at home. And all spring long, all the jocks in my grade,
especially Cody Frederick, who I always thought smelled like an old urinal cake in a locker room, sorry, kept saying, "Can't wait for football. You're going out, right, Reinstein? We're gonna kick some ass in the fall." "I guess," I tell them. I didn't enjoy the jock bus rides. I missed Gus, my first best friend, who sometimes sat on the hill watching track practice, shaking his head in disapproval. But I loved to run. Loved it. Fast like donkey. Very fast. Zing! But then at regionals, the qualifier for the state meet, because I was filled with donkey adrenaline that made me shake, because I knew, seriously understood, that I'd gotten as fast as that jerk Ken Johnson, and I had a good shot at beating him and making him feel like the jerk he is, I false-started twice. Yes, two times, and was disqualified, and then... oh, I'm not proud. I cried, and blew chunks right there by the track. I did, vomited, and then, drum roll, it was all over. Ken Johnson whispered, "Head case." A couple other seniors whispered, "Squirrel nuts," for that was my nickname with the upper classes. Coach Knout said, "Another year of experience and that won't happen to you, my boy." Gus showed up outside the locker room and said, "You should quit stupid track because it's foolish and dumb. Because track made it so I didn't have time to drive around with him and Peter Yang." He didn't have to say that, by the way. Track was done for me for the year. And Cody Frederick said, "We'll kick ass come fall, Reinstein." For the next 5 days, I stayed home. I didn't go to school because I was wrecked by the false starts. I didn't barf anymore, but I felt sick. I felt sweaty. I couldn't eat. I couldn't rest. Moist sheets, disgusting. Didn't smell good. Jerry paced around the house all day while I lay there. She only stopped pacing to stare at me, or to go be a crossing guard for an hour. By day 6, I was pretty hungry, so I ate a couple of bagels. And that was that. No more track. Sophomore year was almost over. Summer was almost here. While track was going, I felt I had a reason for getting out of my bed. Beat Ken Johnson. Without track, I was back to lying in bed wondering if I'm funny. I really wanted to be a comedian. Maybe I still do. Chapter 3. Proof in May I shouldn't be a comedian. A. Nobody laughed at my jokes except for Gus, who was my best friend. He thinks I'm hilarious, of course, but he's been my best friend forever, so he's biased. My so-called second best friend, Peter Yang, he never laughed at anything. What funny man would hang out with a dude who never laughs? B. In 7th grade, I did the school talent show, and I ripped a routine right square out of my Jerry Seinfeld Live on Broadway, I'm Telling You for the Last Time DVD, and nobody laughed. Jerry Seinfeld is hilarious. He's a comic genius. Everybody laughs at him. I did his shtick, and I got nothing except for Ben Schilling shouting at me to get off the stage. Yes, he got detention, and also a couple of other kids booing. That means the bearer of the jokes wasn't funny. I was the bearer, if you didn't get that. C. When I talked, I often talked way too fast, sometimes so fast I even annoyed myself, not to mention others, especially when I talked too fast in my head, which for most of my life I've done 24/7, which is not funny. This can still be a problem. Shut up, voice in head. Not funny. Not funny. Seriously. Not funny. Let us address some larger issues, shall we? My dad must be part of this discussion. I used to think about my dad a lot. I used to think he was with me wherever I went, and that made me feel good. I used to ask him for help and ask him to keep me safe, which is weird. He's dead. I thought a ghost was keeping an eye on me. Aha! When I was 11, it occurred to me that he killed himself. I found him when I was 5. So he obviously didn't want to be with me at all because he made sure he'd never see me again no matter what, so I stopped kidding myself that my dad's ghost was hanging around taking care of me. Hanging around is a bad way to put it.
Ha ha. See?
None of that's funny. Let's address the bonfire. There really aren't any pictures of Dad left because when I was 7, Jerry had this giant bonfire to help me and Andrew let go of the past. We listened to Celtic music and burned Dad's books and shirts and photo albums, etc. Just about everything. Well, not totally everything. You can't burn memories, Jerry. I guess you know that now. I have some memories. Here's a memory. One time, when I was maybe 4, Dad put me in our old Volvo station wagon, a car Jerry got rid of around the time of the bonfire, even though I screamed, "No!" and drove us out to the big mound east of town, an important mound. I sat down at the bottom while Dad jogged up and down it, which doesn't make a lot of sense given what I knew about Dad from Jerry, a short, fat dad. He jogged, and I played in the dirt or whatever, and he jogged. And I remember shouting at him, "Daddy, Daddy," etc., and he jogged. When he stopped, he was all sweaty, and he walked over to me and whispered, "That's better. That's better." Then he said, "What the hell are you doing, Felton?" I believe I was eating a rock. I remember the Volvo smelled funny on the drive back because he was so sweaty. Not exactly like Cody Frederick funny, but sort of. When we got home, Dad said, "Thanks for accompanying me, buddy." That was nice. I really loved that car. It was freaking huge. But Jerry said it had bad vibes. So it went away like all Dad's pictures. I do have some memories, though. Not funny ones. Let's delve into Jerry a bit. While I was home from school, sweating and not eating after my regional screw-up, Jerry, between her crossing guard shifts, often stood at the landing of the stairs that lead into the basement, where my room is and where I watch TV. She would stand there and watch me sleeping, except I wasn't asleep. I was watching Comedy Central. I would pretend to sleep when I'd hear her creep down the stairs so I wouldn't have to talk to her, as she had taken to saying very weird things, very incomprehensible things that my brain did not understand. I'd squint my eyes so they looked closed, but they were open just enough to continue watching Comedy Central. Sometimes, she'd stand there looking at me for a whole episode of Mad TV, and I'd get uncomfortable and want to move, but I didn't because her freakiness was freaking me out. Sometimes I could hear her swallowing, like she was crying or something, which was totally weird. I got disqualified from a stupid track meet, for God's sake. I was pretty upset, but it wasn't so tragic that my mom should have been crying about it. You know what? Of course she wasn't crying about the track meet. I was just a dumb kid back in May. One day she stood there for like an hour, swallowing and staring, and it just got to be too much. I had an itch on my leg and couldn't hold on anymore, so I said, "Can I help you, Jerry?" She flinched and said, "No, just checking on you." "Okay," I said. "I don't think it's bad to be in sports, Felton." "Why the hell would it be?" "Incomprehensible." Then she went upstairs. Incomprehensible jokes aren't funny, by the way. And finally, let's address Bluffton. Disclaimer. Jerry says I shouldn't say retard all the time because it's disrespectful to people who have really low IQs, but that's not what I'm talking about, you know? I sincerely apologize to anyone I offend by saying retard. Okay. There have been times when I truly feel like I'm a retard and that everybody thinks I'm retarded, and because they think I'm retarded, I get nervous and I act like a retard, which simply fulfills their expectation. It's a big circle, the retarded circle of my life. Am I retarded? Well, I am a Reinstein. I live on the outskirts of a small town in southwestern Wisconsin, on 10 acres from which I can see the town's little country club and golf course, which I've called ugly. From my home, I can also see all the alcoholic, blithering golf dads who swear and scream. I blamed my dad for this situation, for abandoning us here by hanging himself in the garage. And I also blame Jerry because she's from here and should have known better. I believe Bluffton, Wisconsin is a terrible place. On good days, this is what I've thought. I'm not retarded. Bluffton is retarded. It has a dumb little college, which is why my dad came here, to teach. Mostly all the students at the dumb little college are dumb, and they think they're king shit or whatever because they're drunk and walking around shouting and in college. Other than the college, Bluffton has a dumb main street where kids my age stand around staring at each other, or if they're old enough and have access to a car, they drive up and down the street staring at the dumb kids staring at each other. Sometimes they drive to Walmart, which is really big. Bluffton also has a McDonald's and a Subway and a Pizza Hut and a combo KFC Taco Bell. Ken Taco Frickin' Bell. Retarded. And there are lots of hills and lots of farms outside the city limits and lots of farmers who drive their pickup trucks and smell like poop and lots of black and white cows standing on the hills staring at you like you're a retard or like you're a kid on Main Street. And listen to this. I never even minded cows. I never minded poop-smelling farmers, even though they can be mean and gross. They blow snot out of their noses onto the snow. Farmers and their poop-smelling kids are not why Bluffton has seemed retarded and why me and my friends have called it Suckville. Me, Peter, and Gus, my only friends forever, figured the facts out in eighth grade. The reason we wanted to rename Bluffton Suckville is because of the town kids. The public school teachers' kids, and the lawyers' kids, and the doctors' kids, and the cops' kids, and the insurance salespeople's, and the bankers' kids, and the orthodontist's daughter, Abby Sauter, who has been very mean. They're all dumb and annoying, we shouted. They're the retarded ones, we said. They honestly do think they're the special children of God. Gus calls these kids honkies. I don't know why, but it makes me laugh. Even now. Honkies. We aren't honkies. Maybe I am. Me, Peter, and Gus are college kids. That is, kids of college professors. At least I used to be. We are a minority. We are oppressed. At least I used to be. I'm crazy. Gus and I tried to write a horror movie script last year titled The Retarded Honkies of Suckville. We wrote 2 pages, actually. Gus wrote some good jokes. I didn't write any jokes because I wasn't funny. Gus is hilarious. Gus could be a great stand-up comic right now, even though he doesn't want to be. He's really small, and he's got this wad of black hair that's always sort of long, and he ducks his head so his bangs cover his eyes so he can hide the fact that he thinks everybody is just dumb. I know he's under his hair rolling his eyes and making faces. Everybody else knows, too. He used to drive the junior and senior honkies crazy because they knew he was making fun of them, but they couldn't catch him because his hair wad was in front of his eyes. He's so dang funny, hugely hilarious, which is the greatest compliment I can give anybody. He also left for the summer, which threatened to make Bluffton double Suckville, maybe triple Suckville, as I wasn't exactly in love with Peter Yang, who was my remaining friend. Not funny, not funny, not funny. A comedian? I don't think so. It's 1:20 a.m. I am not sleepy. Chapter 4. The Terrible Phone Call of Late May. This is how the summer began. Imagine this. It's the Saturday before the last week of school. I'm lying downstairs on the couch outside my bedroom, down in the basement, lights out, resting with my thoughts and the TV, and sweating hugely because of my disqualification at regionals. Andrew's upstairs in the living room, playing about 10 annoying notes on the piano over and over, singing along with them, totally off-key and very loud, which he does a lot, which I find excessively annoying. The phone rings. Jerry answers, her voice echoing throughout the house.
Oh, no. I'm so sorry, Teresa.
Jerry says Teresa in her best Spanish accent.
Teresa.
Even rolling the R. Jerry thinks she knows Spanish because she took hippie drumming lessons from a dude named Tito a few years ago.
Teresa.
Teresa happens to be Gus's Venezuelan mom. I sit up, which isn't easy as I'm weak from not eating. Is something wrong with Gus?
Of course, Teresa. Felton can do Gus's paper route. He really needs to re-engage.
Paper route? Re-engage? Oh no. Jerry said re-engage, which is code for torture Felton. Gus's ridiculous paper route? Torture! My stomach is rumbling, churning, burning, almost ready to upchuck, except there's no food inside of me. What if something is wrong with Gus?
I'll have Felton call later this morning, Teresa,
Jerry says. I leap from the couch and run upstairs just as Jerry is hanging up the phone. What the hell, Jerry? What's wrong?
Felton, Gus is leaving.
What do you mean? When?
Next weekend. Teresa's mother is gravely ill.
Yeah, she's been sick since third grade, so freaking what?
The doctors don't think she'll make it through the summer, so the Alfonsos are going to Venezuela to be with her.
Aw, hell! What am I supposed to do all summer?
You can help Gus out. He needs a friend.
Who am I gonna chill with, Jerry?
Gus needs help with that route.
Paper route? Come on, he doesn't give a crap.
Well, Teresa does, and I do.
You?
Yes. You're going to help Gus out, do you understand?
Oh, man, Jesus Christ! Come on! Meanwhile, Andrew's plinking the piano behind me, still singing along with those 10 notes. Blah, la, la, blah. Plink, plink, plink. Shut your freaking piano, Andrew. We're in crisis here, I shout. Andrew turns, looks at me, says, What? But stops, which is lucky for him, because I'm about to take him down with some serious karate chopping to the nose, throat, and mouth if he doesn't stop. My F-Bomb Summer by Felton Reinstein. Kick off with a serious sweat fest. Add the absence of best friend, stick in a damn morning paper out, make sure it all goes down in Suckville. Fantastic. Damn, Jerry, I shout. By the way, every time in my life that Jerry has said, Felton needs to re-engage, I've ended up with a new freak tale to add to my squirrel nut history. For example, I had these scary anxiety attacks back in fourth grade. I kept thinking my heart wasn't pumping right, which seriously terrified me, of course, and me being scared would make it pump faster. So because it pumped faster, I got more scared, so it pumped faster and faster and faster, which was complete proof to me that my heart was completely malfunctioning and was about to explode, and I'd get dizzy and squeaky-voiced and sick and not be able to breathe, sucking for air while Mrs. Durrell, my teacher, went on and on about Wisconsin's first settlers who I can't remember because my heart was killing me. I think they wore straw hats and suspenders. Jerry took me to a doctor who said my heart was fine, but I seemed to be anxious. No crap. Jerry was so relieved. But the doctor's opinion didn't help me because it kept happening, my heart attacks. So I stopped wanting to go to school because the heart attacks always happened at school. After me refusing to go to school for a week, Jerry said I needed to learn to re-engage. So she took me to a cognitive behavioral therapist. The cognitive behavioral therapist suggested that when I start to have a freak out, and they think my seriously healthy heart isn't working right, I should look at somebody I know well in my class, a person I like a lot, and repeat his or her name 3 times to remember I have good friends and I'm not alone
and everything will be okay. The therapist also said that I should breathe deep to calm down my heart, all of which I sincerely tried to do, except I was probably supposed to say Gus's name in my head, not out loud. Because when I did it during Mrs. Durrell's lecture on immigrants making sausages in Milwaukee, the world fell silent and the whole class turned and stared at me, their eyeballs popping out of their heads like they were looking at the famous nose-picking gorilla at the Milwaukee Zoo, completely gross and weird, which made my heart bang in my chest, completely proving I was dying. Imagine all of them staring at me with their mouths open wide. For years after that, my classmates would whisper softly to me, "Gus, Gus, Gus," and look at me sweetly, but not sweet at all. That's not funny either, by the way. If Gus weren't my best friend and also sort of lacking in friends himself, he would probably have stopped being my friend because he caught so much crap too. That wasn't the only time Jerry suggested I re-engage. There are probably 10 more incidents I could report through the years, but it's late, 1:23 a.m. And after I'd re-engage and freak out because of re-engaging, Jerry always ended up having to keep me home from school for weeks at a time and had to hug me a lot and cook me grilled cheese sandwiches and say sorry over and over. All that stopped. I made myself stop freaking out so much starting a couple of years ago. I got tired of being the center of attention. I don't like attention. Didn't, anyway. And I got tired of being hugged, and I got tired of Jerry saying sorry to me. It's not like Jerry murdered Dad. Dad murdered Dad, right? But I suppose my post-regional dry heaving put Jerry back in the mood. Re-engage. Re-engage, donkey. I sure didn't like Jerry saying the word re-engage. 2 days after Teresa's call, I ate those bagels and regained some of my strength and sanity. I went back to school in time to turn in my English research report about what I want to be when I grow up, titled Stand-Up Comedy, Take My Wife, Please, and to take my stupid finals and to bid fare thee well to the senior class full of honkies and poop stinkers and, of course, to Gus, who was leaving. I'm sorry, Felton, Gus said as we exited Bluffton High on the last day of school, the sun beating down on our heads, our eyes squinty. You should be, I said as we walked toward the bike rack. I don't have any friends in Caracas, man, he grimaced, unlocking his bike. I don't have any friends in Suckville, I said as we pedaled away. What about Peter Yang? He asked, now a block from the school. Something's gone amiss, I told him, a look of resignation on my face. At least Peter Yang has a driver's license, he said, nearing his turn off. That's true, I agreed as he turned. We can Skype, dude, he shouted, biking away. Chapter over, I mumbled, heading toward home. Bleak, bleak, bleak. Summer, summer, summer. Chapter 5. I mean, man, I used to love summer. I have very fond memories, actually. Every summer before this summer, we'd go camping at least once. For example, the summer after freshman year, Jerry took me and Andrew camping at Wyalusing State Park, right where the Wisconsin River cuts the state and hits the Mississippi, where there are really high bluffs and huge trees and watery sandbars and little streams that look like mountain streams on TV flowing down the bluffs and ravines that cut through the forest and hiking trails right through it all. We spent 2 full days exploring. Even though I hadn't hit my growth spurt and hadn't become stupid fast, I was already a jumper. I'd leap across ravines and Jerry would shout, "Felton's a bobcat!" And Andrew, who apparently didn't think athletic prowess was bad for a young man at that time, would ask me to do it again because I looked so cool in flight. At night, Jerry made campfires, and we roasted marshmallows and we sat around and sang while she played guitar. She sang me "You Are My Sunshine" like 20 times, which I really liked,
and all three of us sang Rocky Mountain High and Country Road. Jerry's a great singer. She sounds professional. "Love me some John Denver," she'd say. She's a good mom, too. She's really been a good mom. Really. She took us camping every summer before this summer. And I've loved summer. Chapter 6. But this summer? It surely didn't start out so well. So I was down at the nursing home the other day minding my own business when... That might be a good way to begin a comedy routine, but it's total crap if it's an actual description of what you do every morning. Oh yeah, I know a thing or two about nursing homes. For example, you know what isn't pretty? Old ladies in their underwear. You know what I got to see lots of? Old ladies in their underwear. In fact, this summer, I saw no fewer than 10,000 old ladies in their underwear. That's because one of my big stops on Gus's ridiculous paper route was a nursing home. Ridiculous. Lots of times when I ran through there delivering the state journal, the old ladies would shout, "Get me out of here!" Oftentimes, the old ladies were wearing old lady robes or morning dresses or whatever, and the clothing wasn't tied right or it had slid down wrong, and I got to see their old lady underwear with an old lady in it, which made me very sad. What also made me sad was the very fact that nursing homes even exist because they're hot, stinky prisons for innocent old ladies who have lived too long. Like, that's a crime. Not that all of them were old. One lady was actually sort of young. Whenever she saw me, her eyeballs popped out of her head, and she screamed and waved her arms and freaked out, apparently for good reason. More on that later, if I can stay awake. Through email, Gus told me to never look the inmates in the eyes, which was easy for him because of his hair wad. Not for me. My hair is curly and can't cover my eyes no matter how much I grow it and comb it down. Boing! The sound of my hair springing upward. I biked so damn fast when I got out of that place. I would just want to run away and never go back, but totally knew I'd be back the next day. Paper route. Jesus. Looked like a banner summer. Poor Gus was unhappy, too. He wrote that hanging with his grandma was like hanging at the nursing home all day, all summer long. Then he said it smelled like tacos in Caracas, but he hadn't yet found any tacos to eat. I answered back that I was bored and hot and tired, and I couldn't stop eating. And Jerry was being weird, and Andrew hadn't taken a shower since school got out. "We're losers," was his reply. He also said, "Tell Andrew he must clean himself." Chapter 7. Then someone moved into Gus's house. Like 10 days after Gus left for Venezuela, the lights went back on. And someone in there ordered the newspaper, which meant I had to deliver a paper to Gus's house every day. Aaliyah. But I didn't know that yet. So I wasn't happy at all with this development. See, there's nothing fun about visiting your friend's house when he's not home because he's in Venezuela with his dying grandma, and he sends emails about taco smells and says we're losers, and his house just reminds you of how great it would be to go down to the rec room and sit down in one of the giant beanbag chairs they have down there and watch some movies and eat chips and shoot the bull and exchange some serious laughs, instead of having to visit that house at the butt crack of dawn just to dump a newspaper in the screen door and then bike away to another 15 houses that don't contain your friend, including a big house full of crazy old ladies who are really prison inmates. Peter Yang's house is on that route, too, but it was clear things weren't going well between us, although we hadn't talked. I mean, that's really it, we hadn't talked. Plus, his house smells like fish, so I don't like going in anyway. The people who moved into Gus's house for the summer redecorated it immediately, which I felt was a gesture meant to rub my nose in the fact of Gus's absence. The second morning I delivered the paper there, the curtains on the picture window were open, and I could see that all the photos that are usually above the couch had been replaced by a bunch of scary wood masks. Boo! I mean, scary. Boo! So I stood out there gawking and terrified, thinking about all the pictures of the Venezuelan mountains that used to be there, and what Gus must be seeing, which I wouldn't know because he couldn't get Skype to work on the computer he had in Caracas, and I already mentioned that his emails were so short at that time. They got longer by the time I didn't want to read them. When all of a sudden, the front door swung open, and this black girl about my age was standing there in her white nightie or whatever, staring at me. My jaw dropped. My eyeballs popped out of my head in total cartoon style. Boing, oing, oing. That's the sound of my eyeballs popping. Okay, all over town, there are a lot of people who aren't exactly appropriately dressed when you're opening doors at the butt crack of dawn. Oh, good morning, Mr. Schroeder. I can see your wang. Yeek. This girl, though, was much better to look at. So when she opened the door, she and me and the black girl, we stared at each other, open-mouthed, silent. She at the door, me in the bushes in front of the picture window where I'd had my nose pressed to the glass. Both of us poised to flee because I probably looked like a criminal, and she was beautiful and not Gus. I couldn't breathe. Finally, she said, all out of breath, "What do you want?" "Paperboy," I said. "What?" she asked, standing straight, her fear receding. "Paper," I said, tossing the newspaper I had in my hand onto the step in front of her. I nodded at her. She looked down at the paper, then back up at me. I couldn't breathe. So I totally kicked it. Quick twitch. I leapt to my bike and got the holy hell out of there. I looked over my shoulder as I pedaled away. She stood there staring at me, her mouth open. God. Dork. And oh, yes, I'd sprung like a hunted, retarded, highly athletic gazelle. Or donkey. Hee-haw, idiot. To show that I was not, even then, completely lacking in understanding of social appropriateness, I'll say...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.